Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. So let's continue our lab safety video series with the fourth video. We're going to continue looking at the hazards. We're going to go into the chemical, electrical, and radioactive and fire hazards. So let's start with chemical hazards. So the OSHA hazard communication standard requires that all chemicals to be labeled, and the labels have to have the identity of the chemical, so what it is, and the chemical manufacturer. A proper hazard warning with pictograms. So like on this one, it says danger, and then it has a hazard statement. The danger is a signal word. The hazard statement here says toxic if ingested. And then it has pictograms, you know, in case somebody that picks it up doesn't actually know how to read. We have pictures also. Has some precautionary statements and with an explanation of the hazard and first aid measures in case of exposure. So never ever use a chemical that is not labeled. For illustration purposes, you have two clear liquid substances here. One is distilled water, the other one is ethyl alcohol. If they were in unmarked and labeled containers, you really wouldn't be able, just looking, to tell one from the other. Now, smelling them, you could possibly tell one from the other, but then, you know, ethyl alcohol, you may not be able to distinguish it from like isopropyl alcohol or something like that. So you have to have these in a label container. Even water has to be in a label container. So OSHA requires that each chemical come with a safety data sheet that provides information about the chemical, the hazard, and the procedures for cleanup and first aid. These reports are divided up in 16 sections. They are standardized. Everybody have to abide with the same format. And each portion of those 16 sections provides specific information on that chemical. We can use a Department of Transportation label or a National Fire Protection Association label. And these can be used to identify the hazardous material. So these pictures here on the slide down here represent DOT ones. If you have paid attention when you're driving on the road and you're behind a truck, a lot of times if there contains something that might be dangerous, those signs are going to be in the back of the truck. So it's good to pay attention to that. Same thing on train cars. So to appropriately warn anybody that's close or around, whatever, whether it's, you know, flammable or radioactive or explosive or something like that. The NFPA labels look like this. These are very standard. So a little diamond with four colors. Blue is a health hazard. The higher the number, the more hazardous it is. Four is the highest. Red is for fire. Yellow is for reactivity, and then this white one here is for specific hazard, and that one usually has a symbol of some sort. So this is where you would see the symbol for radioactive. Don't use any water. It's corrosive, acid, alkali, or it's an oxidizer. To reduce the risk of exposure, first you should follow the written chemical hygiene plan. The chemical hygiene plan is in each lab. List all of the chemicals and the data safety sheets and everything and what the protocols are if you've been exposed and how to deal with that. You need to treat all chemicals as hazardous and always wear the proper protective equipment. And of course, follow protocols and instructions carefully. For example, if the protocol says to add an acid to water, do not add the water to the acid instead, because that could be dangerous. When any potential hazardous solutions or chemical is being used, you have to have protective equipment for your eyes, face, head, and extremities, as well as protective clothing or barriers that should be used. Any volatile or fuming solutions should be used under a fume hood so that you don't breathe the stuff in. And because, you know, if you breathe something in into your lungs, it crosses straight over into your bloodstream and it can go into your brain. So you really want to protect yourself and use those under a fume hood. The fume hoods help to expel noxious and hazardous fumes away from you, from those chemical reagents. They definitely should be inspected for blockages, ventilation velocity, so make sure that you have nothing impeding that airflow that's pulling those fumes. And it should never be operated with the sash fully opened, because then you cannot get that suction of the fumes. And there's a maximum operating sash height should be established, and you shouldn't exceed that. In case of accidental contact with hazardous solution or a contaminated substance, you have to have quick actions. When an accident happened, again, if you weren't wearing PPE, make sure that you put PPE on to work with chemicals, especially protecting your eyes, having at least a lab coat on and some gloves. If a chemical spills on you, you have to flush the affected area continuously for a minimum of 15 minutes. And then proceed to the emergency room for further evaluation. If a chemical spills on the floor or work surface, you have to alert personnel of the danger and then follow the proper laboratory protocol for cleanups. And the protocol just really depends on what has been spilled. Next, we have radioactive hazards. So radioactive materials are used to perform diagnostic tests and deliver treatment. Think of radioactive iodine as a treatment for hyperthyroidism. Phlebotomists may be exposed to small amounts of radioactive materials when they draw blood from a patient that is receiving radioactive treatments or undergoing the imagery with a radioactive substance. So the guidelines are, first, you really need to be able to recognize that radioactive hazard symbol. Here it is. Obviously, be extra cautious in any area that has radioactive materials, and know your institution's procedures. And females, if you are pregnant and in your first trimester, just don't even go there. Don't go around anybody that's been exposed to radiation. Hand that work off to somebody else. Do not expose yourself and your baby unnecessarily. Next, we have electrical hazards. So shock or fire can result from electrical apparatus, and everything that we use just about in the lab is electrical. So avoid using extension cords. Equipment should be plugged into usually a surge protector power block of some sort, and it is plugged into the wall. You need to report frayed cords, overloaded circuits, and ungrounded equipment. Unplug equipment before servicing it. And so sometimes we do, as techs, have to work on equipment, and it should be turned off and unplugged. Personnel should not handle electrical equipment in connections with wet hands. Okay, so you could have, you know, even wet gloves, you know, if you have serum or something on your gloves. And electrical equipment should not be used after liquid has been spilled on it. Do not open equipment marked with an electrical caution warning, and note a location of the circuit breaker box, and avoid contact with electrical equipment while drawing blood, again, because you're around liquids and stuff, and liquids and electricity don't mix well. What happens if there is an electrical shock? What's the emergency response? So first, you need to turn off the equipment. And so you can do that by either pulling the plug, or if that's not possible, switch off the circuit breaker, which is why you need to know where the circuit breaker is. Don't touch the victim until the risk of further shock is removed, because if the victim is still being shocked and you touch them, you will be shocked, right? The electricity, the body is a very good conductor of electricity. And here it says, of course, call 911. That's our emergency number in the U.S., whatever your emergency number is overseas, which you need to dial that number, and you need to start CPR if needed and keep the victim warm. If you are in a hospital facility, there's usually a number that you call for a rapid response team, or code blue, or whichever is appropriate for your facility. Next, we have fire and explosive hazards. So fire is a chemical reaction that involves the rapid oxidation of combustible material or fuel, and it liberates heat and light. There are four factors needed for a fire: fuel, ignition source, oxygen, and a reaction chain. Fire drills should be conducted regularly. This is where the fire alarm sounds, and then personnel has to take the proper precautions. Often in a hospital, when a fire drill happens and the fire alarm is pulled, all the fire doors should shut, and you cannot prop them open. You need to keep everything, all the doors shut. So there are certain protocols to do, depending on which area you're in, to abide by the fire drill protocols. So if there really is a fire, you should evacuate all personnel and patients, right? Don't be leaving them patients behind. So there are a couple of acronyms to help you understand and remember what to do in the event of a fire or an explosion. The first one is RACE, so R-A-C-E, Rescue, Alarm, Confine, and Extinguish. So rescue meaning remove any patients that is in the area of immediate danger where the fire risk is present, so move them to safety, then raise the alarm, pull the alarm, call 911. Then confine, so you have to close all windows and doors to contain the fire. And so this one of the closing the doors in a hospital for sure are fireproof. And so it's imperative that all of those get closed. And then if possible, extinguish the fire. If the fire is small or contained, you can use a fire extinguisher or a blanket to put out. So the PASS acronym is for how to operate a fire extinguisher. So it's pull the pin, aim at the base of the fire, squeeze the handle, and sweep back and forth. The classes of fire are class A. Those are ordinary combustibles, wood, paper, cloth. You can use an A or an ABC extinguisher on those. Class B are flammable liquids and gases. So this could be grease, oil, and flammable liquids. Like in the lab would be like alcohol, ethyl alcohol, etc. I use also an ABC, OBC, or halogenated agents. Class C is electrical equipment. You need to use a C fire extinguisher. So we have electrical equipment, so it could catch fire. Class D is flammable powdered metals. You have to use a D extinguisher and special equipment. Those are usually not around in the lab. So in most labs, you have an ABC fire extinguisher, so it covers classes A, B, and C. Class E, fires cannot be extinguished, so you definitely need a fire department. And then class K have to do with cooking oils and grease, but like in big commercial kitchens where it's going to be a little bit more dangerous. And there's a specific K fire extinguisher and special equipment that can be used to handle big grease fires that happen in commercial kitchens. And so think in a hospital, it would be in a cafeteria type of kitchen. And, this is where maintenance of the kitchen is really important, and cleaning, degreasing, etc., because grease fires are hard to extinguish. So then the types of fire extinguishers that we've already kind of denoted, you have class A, that is pressurized water, foam, and multi-purpose dry chemical. Classes B and C are a multi-purpose dry chemical, carbon dioxide, and halogenated hydrocarbons. These are for computers, the halogenated hydrocarbons. And then the ABC fire extinguishers use monoammonium phosphate, and it can be used on classes A, B, and C, which is, again, what you're most likely to see in a hospital or a clinical setting. Class D are going to be dry chemical extinguishers, and only trained firefighters can use those. Then we have the hazard of compressed gases. So this would be your oxygen tanks. So you want to store the tanks vertically and always keep cylinders secured, so strapped into their location. Never store flammable liquids and compressed gases together, because that could cause an explosion. And do not force any frozen cylinder valve. And then you have to let the companies that handle the compressed gases and all that do the maintenance and fix any of the things that happen if these are damaged. Next, we have labware hazards. So you want to exercise caution to prevent unnecessary or accidental breakage. This is if you're using glass equipment. So most labware currently used is discarded when broken. Any broken or cracked labware should be discarded in a special container for broken glass. Don't throw it in a regular waste container. Common sense should be used in storing labware. So you wouldn't put heavy pieces really up high. You would put them on lower shelves. And you would put tall pieces behind smaller pieces so you don't knock them down trying to reach the smaller pieces. And shelves should be installed at reasonable heights, and labware should not be stored out of reach. It shouldn't be difficult for you to get to what you need. Magnetic resonance imaging hazards. So the MRI machine is a big old giant magnet. And magnets attract metal, and so you need to take precautions to avoid serious risk or damage. So all metallic objects have to be removed, and if a patient or a employee has an implanted metallic device, they may be barred from entering the MRI suite, because if they do, they're going to be pulled like a, you know, by the magnet straight to the magnet of the MRI. And if there's a device, like, it could pull the device out of their body also. It can cause serious damage. If the wheelchair, for example, that the patient's on has a lot of metal in it and actually can attract the wheelchair and stick it to the magnet, then you have to power down the MRI machine, etc. So exercise caution around MRI. And then lastly, we're going to talk about emergency first aid procedures. So CPR, which everybody that works in any kind of healthcare setting should be trained in CPR. And you have to determine if the patient is conscious, if the patient is breathing, and if needed, perform chest compressions. And for bleeding, you need to elevate limb and apply direct pressure until medical assistance is available if there is excessive bleeding in one of the limbs. And for shock, you definitely call for assistance. Keep the victim lying down, elevate the legs, keep the victim warm, and keep the airway open. And then lastly, a little mention about disaster emergency plan. You have to know your institution's procedures so that you're prepared. Also know what your role might be in the event of a disaster. You may be called to do things that are not normally part of your job. Pay special attention to that, to what your responsibilities are. Again, you could be asked to do things that are beyond what you normally would do. In our area, the most common disaster is going to be either a tornado or flash flooding. So know what it's likely to happen. But I mean, we're not out in an area, we're not beyond like having like earthquake or something like that. So anyway, know what you could get and how to respond, and that's going to be good for you. Okay, so this wraps up all the different hazards, and our next ones are going to be about infection control. So again, thank you for your attention.